بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Indeed, all praise is due to Allah, and as such we should praise Him, seek His help, and seek refuge in Him from the evil which is within ourselves and the evil which results from our deeds. For whomsoever Allah has guided, none can misguide, and whomsoever Allah has allowed to go astray, none can guide. And I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last messenger of Allah. The topic of this evening's presentation, as was mentioned, is fasting, a way of life. And this topic, of course, is most appropriate because of the fact that we are in the month of Ramadan, the month of fasting. And by this topic, I intend to share with you some thoughts I had on fasting, which I think we all need to reflect on. I need to reflect on it. And hopefully, in our reflection, it would produce action inside of ourselves, which would later transform our fast into something which was in accordance with what Allah has intended for us from fasting. In saying that, I'm implying that perhaps many of us, if not most of us, are missing out on the essence of fasting. That fasting for us has become a cultural tradition which we do every year. We did in our countries, the countries that we came from. Everybody shares in it. It's a time of festivity, nice foods, etc., etc. But in terms of fasting having an impact, a positive impact on our lives, that we can say when we turn and look at last year's fast and look at ourselves this year and how our fast is going this year, can we turn back and look at it and say, I have grown from last year to this year? There has been a tangible change in my personality, my spirituality, my character. Has there really been a change? These are the questions which I ask myself, and I think that you all need to ask yourselves. Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam informing us, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ, that I was only sent to perfect for you the highest of character traits, told us in that statement that fasting is intended to change our character. So if we are not experiencing a change, then we are not achieving the actual goals of fasting. There is something missing. Fasting is a yearly ritual, a cultural habit, a traditional practice. These are the terms which are usually used to describe our fasting. So much so that we find people who will fast in Ramadan, but they don't pray. They will not even pray, but they will fast. I mean, I've met a number of quote-unquote Muslims, you know, who fast and don't pray. And when I ask them, you know, how can you fast, or why are you fasting when you don't pray? Well, they say, well, you know, fasting is just once a year, you know. Whereas prayer is like something you have to do every day, every day, every day, you know. So fasting is a lot easier because you just do it once a year and then it's gone, finished. I met myself personally when I first came into Islam back in the 70s and in Toronto. I grew up in Toronto, and people, you know, who were there, most of them were immigrants like yourselves, who were explaining different things about Islam to me. And I remember one friend of mine, a Moroccan, very nice brother, who was good practicing Muslim, he told me that, you know, back home in Morocco, many of his friends, I mean, he wasn't doing this, but he said many of his friends would break their fast with hashish. They break their fast with hashish. I mean, this is the state. I mean, he was trying to explain to me this thing of culture and really what Islam is about and how, you know, to be aware of that. Why? Because, you know, people come into Islam, they're very enthusiastic, you know, Islam should really make a person, and then they meet Muslims from different parts of the Muslim world and they find them not matching up to the standard, you know. And it's, sometimes it can be very devastating emotionally, you know, psychologically, spiritually, it can be very devastating. So he was trying to prepare me, you know, to be aware of this difference of the cultural practices, you know, this so fast and had become that in his culture. Muslims saying, for example, that we gain weight in Ramadan. You know, and for non-Muslims, it's a very shocking thing. You know, how you fasted for 30 days, and at the end of that, you know, you step on the scale, you've, you know, gained 5-10 kilos. How is that? It seems to contradict, you know. How can you fast and lose and gain weight? You know, what happened to them? And especially because our fast seems so severe to them. You know, no food, no drink, nothing, you're not putting, because for them to fast, of course, fasting, the few of them that fast, the Catholics, that they have Lent, they're fasting, you give up chocolates, you know, you give up, this is a fast, right, you know, for 1 week, you know. So when they see our fast, they see this severe, you know, no food, no drink, no, it's really harsh. You gain weight after all of that? How? You know, it's something very shocking. But you see, all of it is a reflection of this cultural aspect of the fast amongst us today. And when we go back to look to see what is it really that the fast was designed to develop, I mean, what is it that Allah really wanted from us in the fast? We see it in the verse from the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. O you who believe, fasting is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you in order that you would become pious, in order that you would fear Allah. Taqwa is the goal of fasting. And Allah says there that it was prescribed for us as it was prescribed for those before us, pointing to the concept that fasting is not something unique in Muslim tradition, in Islam as taught by the final messenger of Allah to humankind, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if one goes to the scriptures of the Christians and the Jews, Exodus, one of the books of the Old Testament, considered to be a part of the Torah today, Exodus 34, verse 28, it describes when Prophet Musa went to receive the commandments from Allah. And he was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He neither ate bread nor drank water. And he wrote upon the table the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. Prophet Musa fasted for 40 days and 40 nights without eating any bread or any food or drinking anything. A complete fast. And you can also find in the New Testament, which is the documents or scriptures which are followed by the Christians, in Matthew's 4 verse 2, describing Prophet Jesus. And he fasted 40 days and 40 nights. And afterwards, he was hungry. This is showing that fasting was a part of the way of the prophets, the sunnah of the prophets of the past. Of course, this fast, 40 days, 40 nights, complete fast, means there's no break in the fast. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was reported to do the same kind of fast, but he forbade us from doing it. Wisal, it is called. Wisal. This type of fasting is forbidden for the followers of the prophets. Permissible for them, but forbidden for the followers, because Allah provides sustenance for them, as the Prophet ﷺ explained, you know, in ways that we cannot grasp and we don't obtain. For us to try to fast in this way, we'd be dead after a few days. You know, so obviously it is not something to be prescribed for us. So our fasting ends at sunset. But it is a complete fast. And which is showing that the fast which is practiced amongst the Catholics today is a shambles. You know, fasting for them is nothing now. It is nothing of the way of Jesus. They claim to follow Jesus, but they're not fasting anywhere near what he fasted. But what is he showing us? That this was the way of the prophets, alayhi salam. And this is what they taught their followers. This is something Allah prescribed with the earliest of the prophets. The prophets fasted, and their followers, their righteous followers, also fasted. Fasting to develop, as Allah explained, from our times to their times, to develop taqwa, a consciousness of Allah. A consciousness which would lead us to righteousness. Because taqwa is the heart of righteousness. Consciousness of Allah is the heart of goodness. If it is missing, then goodness is like a body without a soul or without a heart. It's just a shell. It's not real. And this is why when you find non-Muslims, atheists, etc., who say, we are good not because we believe in a God and there is reward for being good and punishment for being bad. We are good because we know that good is good. We can see, we understand that it is good, and that's why we do this good. Is what they like to promote, this idea that their goodness is, you know, beyond this issue of reward and punishment, God is, you know, being over us. We are good because we know it is good. Intellectually we can see this is good, so we do it. The reality is that this good that they do without taqwa, which they see as good, they will do it as long as it is convenient. This is when you get down to the realities of it. As long as it's convenient, yes, they will do it. But when it becomes inconvenient, that good now is going to create problems for themselves, then you find they're not going to do it. Or if they find around them everybody is doing bad and getting away with it, then they'll do it also. They'll do the bad thing. Because no real benefit in it anymore. So they're good, though they say it is because it is good. No, no, it's because it is convenient to do it. They will do it only Allah as long as it's convenient. And you can see this in people's lives in general. I know my own personal experience. When I visited New York City in 1981, after there had been a blackout, the electric grid had gone down in New York City for about 3 years, three days, New York City. And of course, for many of you coming from Pakistan or India or Egypt or whatever, that's not unusual. So it happens all the time because it's a big deal, right? Well, for New York City, yeah, it was a big deal. I mean, the idea of electricity gone in the city for 3 days, this is something unheard of. Well, what happened? I mean, I arrived there about 2 days after they got the electricity back on again. When I came into New York City, you know, went into Brooklyn, the Bronx, I was shocked what I saw. I was shocked. The place looked like Berlin after World War II. You know? And the place was just in shambles. I mean, you could not find a store, you know, whose windows were not broken in. All of the stores were broken in, doors bashed in, everything. They were putting up, you know, wood, nailing wood just to stop people from going in there afterwards. Because, and they were showing on television what was going on during those 3 nights. The 3 days, nothing was happening. The place was fine, right? Because during the 3 days, policemen were on patrol. And, you know, to be a policeman in New York, like here, I mean, you have to be at least 6'2". You have to weigh at least 260 pounds, you know? So you're like a gorilla walking the street there, you see? You know, nobody's going to, you know, everybody's going to stay in line, right? Nobody's going to do any bad there, right? So, but now, once the night came, you know, police can't do anything. It's all dark, right? When the night came, then people came out of their houses. Not just men and robbers. No, everybody there. Man, his wife, his kids, they're coming just smashing in the windows of the stores and getting the goods, you know, driving up with their cars, you know. Station wagons just collecting everything. This is
big time.
You know. It's incredible, you know. The people had, you know, newspaper people had photographed much of this in the night because they had cameras with lights and stuff. And again, people think, oh, it's the poor people. You know, poor people in the ghetto and this is people. No! They were showing, there were people driving down with their Mercedes-Benz, coming, you know, from the suburbs, you know. Everybody was there at it. I mean, of course, the people in the Mercedes, I mean, they weren't going to the supermarket. Right? Because that's where the common people are hitting supermarkets, grabbing goods and things like that. You know, the people in the Mercedes, they were going to the fur stores, you know, grabbing, you know, minks and, you know, these expensive furs and jewelry. This is what they were going for. But the whole city was involved in mass looting. You know, this is the most civilized country on the earth here, right? So, you know, so-called, right? Democracy, some, you know, civilization. And they went mad for 3 nights. Why?
Nobody watching that.
Why? Because this was a time when people felt no, you could do evil and get away with it. No policeman is going to stop you or catch you or whatever, you know. So once that opportunity came, the little girl up there, whoever she belongs to, please just... Once the opportunity came for people to get away with bad, then there was no point in being good. No point in being good. That's the reality. Because this is because there is no fear of God there. No fear of God. And I know personally, you know, when I went to study in Medina University, I spent 6 years there in Medina. And when I first got there, and I used to see these policemen in Medina, right? And, you know, in Medina, when the time for prayer comes, they would close up all the stores. And people would have jewelry stores and that, you know, and you see gold and silver, and people just put a piece of cloth over it and go and pray. Yeah? Something, of course, which, you know, you try to do that in any Western City, you know, your store is finished in a minute. You'd see people walking out of the bank with plastic bags filled with money. I mean, you try to do that in New York City or Chicago or Toronto, I mean, you get 3 steps out of the door and somebody's knocked you down and got your money already, right? And I was shocked to see the policemen there. They look like Cub Scouts. You know? Not even Boy Scouts, yeah, but Cub Scouts. Little guys. Big guns, you know. And the gun, you would see they had paper stuffed in the barrel of the gun to make sure dust didn't come in, right? No bullets in the thing. You know. They would catch it, you know, somebody, something happened, whatever, they have to take away the criminal. You see, the criminal is a big guy. You see, like a little boy walking away with him. And he just go. And the sense of security, you know, that I experienced there, and many, you know, Westerners that I've known who've lived there, you know, have expressed that, you know, they felt a sense of security there, which they never feel in the West. During the Gulf War, same thing. I was involved in those who were giving dawah to the American troops, you know, after the Gulf War for 5.5 months, you know, before they were all processed out of the country. And alhamdulillah, more than 3,000 of them accepted Islam, you know, in Dammam, in the one area where I was. You know, this is documented, not just rumors spreading. I put their names on computer and sent it, you know, to the States to help to follow up for them. The point is, many of them had told me that, you know, this is what they experienced, because they would come in from maneuvers, they'd come in late at night, you know, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock at night, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, they would be walking the streets, you know, and the store stayed open knowing that so many of these people were there, and they would be walking the streets at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, and they didn't feel, you know, scared. I mean, because there were women among them and men. There's a number of female troops there too. And they, you know, they expressed to me this sense of security. I mean, normally you go into the middle of a city, any of the big cities in America, you know, past 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, you're walking the streets by yourself. You know, you'd be walking and, you know, always checking your back all the time. You don't feel, there's no sense of security there. But they experienced it. They said, you know, it's one of the things which caused them to really question, you know, what is it that has made this society this way? So, it is that sense of taqwa, even though, and it's not to say Saudi Arabia was the example, the perfect example of Islam in practice, no? But Islam is being implemented there more so than in many other places, and it had that effect on the society. And don't think that, oh, that's just the way things are in Arabia and how it was. No. You go and read the stories of the travelers in Arabia in the early days. People used to come for Hajj. And they had to be, you know, gunmen with their caravans to make sure that raiders wouldn't come and catch them and put them into slavery. You know, yeah, it was dangerous. It was dangerous. It was like the Wild West there, you know, in times past. But with the changeover, with the establishment of Sharia as the law of the country, you know, applying the law, etc., across the board, and, you know, promotion of Islam in the society, education in the society towards Islam, etc., it had this, you know, major impact, you know, on the society. And again, as I said, it is ultimately, you know, taqwa which is at the core of it. And when you look, for example, at the prohibition of alcohol, this is something which all of the major societies recognize as harmful. And America, for 13 years, between 1920 and 1933, they prohibited alcohol. The government, prohibition, they instituted law prohibiting the production and the sale of alcohol for 13 years. But it didn't work. It didn't work. Because the fear of God was not behind it. The consciousness of God was not behind it. So, though many people, the masses of the people, were prevented from being able to consume alcohol, a criminal element developed. This is where Al Capone, You know, when the famous gangsters of that era, Al Capone was, you know, he was making like 60 odd million a year from selling illegal alcohol. That was his business. And people, you know, who had money, the upper segments of the society, they would still have access to alcohol. So it didn't work. Whereas Muslims internationally, not to say that it's the case of all Muslims, because there are Muslims who drink and these things too, but as a whole, without the pressure of law, etc., etc., you do find that the mass of Muslims don't drink. They don't drink. Why? Because of this consciousness of God. It has to do with the consciousness of God. And this is what the fast focuses on, developing that consciousness. We have it to different levels, you know, having been raised or having come into Islam, have been raised as Muslims, whatever. There is a degree of it. I mean, but unfortunately, in the mass of Muslim countries, that degree is very, very small. And this is what I wanted us to reflect on this evening. To what degree are we really working on this in our fasts? When we look back at last Ramadan and the Ramadan before it and before that, can we see any kind of progression? Or is it just the same thing every year? We did it last year, we did it the year before and before and before. It's just an occurrence that happens in our lives every year. This is the thing that we need to reflect on. Because if the issues of taqwa were being developed, were being focused on, then we should be growing from Ramadan to Ramadan. There should be a progressive growth in our spirituality, in our character, etc. But if we look at ourselves and ask ourselves seriously, has there been a growth? Do we feel a change? Then we have to admit that really, it's just the same old, as they say. It's the same thing we're doing each year. So, we need to, again, reflect on the goals and the purposes of Ramadan. And find out what is missing. Well, we know it is something to do with the taqwa, but what is missing which is not allowing taqwa to take its rightful place in our fast? That our taqwa, our fear of Allah, our consciousness of Allah is not increasing. We are not growing with each Ramadan. What is missing? Now, that, what I think, from my observance, in looking at the mode and the method of fasting, I feel that to a large degree, we are far away from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the answer. Whenever Muslims go astray, it will be because they have left the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because his sunnah is the way. If we are holding on firmly to that sunnah, then we will be on the right path. We will be getting from the fast what Allah has prescribed for us. Now if we look at the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his fast, we find that he used to begin the fast suhoor, and he emphasized suhoor. Don't miss it. Even if it's only drinking a glass of water, don't miss it. He used to begin the fast with some olives, some bread, you know, barley bread or whatever. Something very light. And when he broke the fast, he broke the fast with three dates, drank some water, he went to pray, and following that he would have a moderate meal.
a moderate meal. You can't gain weight in Ramadan doing that. So for us to be gaining weight, then it means we are not doing that. What we find is that the tradition is when we begin the fast, because we know we're going to be fasting for the next so many hours, we don't want to feel hungry. So we prepare 3-course meals. You know, we're going into the fast eating, you know, half a chicken and, you know, some, you know, a leg of goat and rice and, you know, biryani or whatever, you know, kabsha, whatever. We just tank up going in. And what happens, of course, is that our systems, you know, overloaded. And I notice in the Emirates where I am, you'll always see before Ramadan comes warnings from the doctors, right? To the population, you know, to control their eating. Don't overeat, because so many people are coming into the hospitals with problems from overeating in Ramadan. So the point is that people, you know, tank up, they go into the fast. What's happening is that the system is just, you know, it's taking time to digest this. And it's working, and it's working, and it's working. You find that it's working all the way through the day. Maybe only about an hour before sunset, it finally finishes work. Then you have sunset coming. Ah, mashallah, time to break the fast. And then when the time comes to break the fast, instead of 3 dates, you know, some water, you know, or some juice, whatever, and going to pray, we pile up in front of ourselves, you know, all these foods, you know, the stuff, very rich stuff with all the sugar and, you know, calories, and, you know, we pile up and we eat and eat and eat, and we eat, and we eat, until, you know, you reach the point, you say, you feel something stuck in your throat. You can't put any more down, right? That's when you finally have to stop. You stop when you reach that point. And of course, when we go to stand for Taraweeh, you know, in this state, right, when your stomach is all full like this, you know, you're tired. You get sleepy, you know. You can hardly stay up with your mom, and you're looking at your watch, thinking, well, hurry up and finish, you know. See? And of course, in this way, we gain weight. This is how we gain weight in Ramadan. Because we're not following the Sunnah. We're not following the Sunnah. So, the fast, which on one hand is to develop a sense of control over our eating habits, eating, drinking habits, the sense of control isn't there. Yes, we are not fasting during the daylight hours, but the real test of control is at the time of the breaking of the fast. This is the time that we're being tested. Have we gained control? Have we learned control? Are we in control? The reality is we're not. Because as soon as that adhan goes, we just let all the reins loose and we're just going for it. There's no control there. There is no control. And when you consider that Prophet Muhammad ﷺ had said that the believer eats as if he has one stomach and the disbeliever as if he has 7, based on that criteria, if we were to judge the Muslims today in their fasting, their breaking of the fast, we would have to say the Muslim, the disbelievers, we're not eating as if we had one stomach. And he said that we should eat a third, drink a third, and leave a third for breathing. Leave a third for breathing, meaning that you never fill your stomach. How many of us can say that we have gone a day without filling our stomachs? Every time we eat to our fill. This is the norm. This is the way that we eat, but this is not from the Sunnah. And the Prophet ﷺ had said that the worst vessel, the worst container that a person can fill is his or her stomach. It's the worst container to fill. And he had identified the stomach as the source of most illnesses. And this is what has medically been shown. Most of the sicknesses and illnesses that people suffer today can be traced back to their eating habits, back to the stomach. And when he spoke of the signs of the last day, he spoke of things to come that would happen amongst Muslims, whether it is that they will drink alcohol, calling it by other than its name, take interest and call it a different name. He's talking about different things. In Sahih Bukhari, you find him saying, وَيَظْهَرُ فِيهِ مُسْلِمًا وَيَظْهَرُ فِيهِ مُسْلِمًا. There will appear among them, amongst the Muslim, fatsoes, fatties, big fat people. Not people who have glandular problems, who normally, you know, you doesn't matter, he eats a little bit, he's still getting fat anyway. You know, that's nobody's held to blame for that. But that Muslims would be known to be fat. They would appear amongst the many. Meaning that you go back in time, you know, the early Muslims and that, you will not see that. It was not the norm. It was not the norm. Today it's the norm. You know? And unfortunately, you'll find amongst, you know, the religious leaders, the shuyukh and so on, so you see that. It's normal. You see the sheikh. Sheikh means big, right. He comes to give you. This is the norm. But this was not the way. This was not the way of the Muslims. The early Muslims is not known. Because this overeating is indicative of something. It's indicative of a lifestyle which is not in keeping with the Sunnah, the way of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know, where we eat enough to keep your back straight, as he would say, you know, what to keep your back straight, you're not, you know, bent over from hunger. This was the way. By maintaining this light meal coming into the fast, moderate meal coming out of the fast, a person then experiences hunger. Meaning that in each day of fasting, he or she will feel hungry. Unfortunately today for us, we don't want to feel hungry. This is why we're eating so much. You don't want to feel hungry. And I remember that, you know, people used to tell me when I first came into Islam, first, you know, year of fasting, you know, they'd ask, how's the fast going, you know, you new Muslim, how's the fast going? It's difficult, you know, this hunger, I'm not really used to it. They say, well, you know, you don't feel hungry, and it's because you're a new Muslim. Eventually, you know, you'll learn. You know, we're Muslim, we don't feel hungry, right? No, the point is that the whole issue of hunger is lost. You know, people don't want to feel hungry. But the thing is that feeling hungry is a part of fasting. We should feel hungry every day. We should feel pangs of hunger. Why? Because in that hunger, and feeling that hunger, it reminds us of those who are hungry, not because they've chosen to fast, but because they have no food to eat. And this should then motivate us to be generous, to seek out those who are needy and to help them. And this is why we have Eid al-Fitr. The celebration for breaking the fast is one of feeding the poor. This is what is supposed to be generated. This is part of what is generated from the fast. An empathy or sympathy for those people who are needy, and generosity. This characteristic should be developed in the course of fasting. But unfortunately, we have missed it. And we are not considering that the fast, if somebody may say to us, so what if I eat, you know, extra, you know, how does that doesn't really affect my faith. And okay, maybe I'm not complying with the letter of the law for the fast, but you know, my faith, I'm still okay. The reality is that this attitude of overeating is indicative of an attitude towards the dunya. You know, when you really get down to it, this desire to eat the way we're eating is an expression of our general desire towards the dunya. We want to grab as much of it as we can. Because really, you know, this habit, when you look at our habits, they're all interrelated. You're not going to be uncontrolled in your eating habits and then controlled in your other habits. No, it means that we're uncontrolled in general. Al-haakum al-takathur. We've forgotten this verse. That this desire to want to grab as much of the dunya as possible has caused them to be unaware of the purpose of this life. That this is what is happening in our lives. That our love for the dunya, our desire to want to get as much of the dunya as possible, this is overwhelming our lives. And naturally, how can one be spiritual in the midst of all that? Where's the role of spirituality in that? Spirituality only develops, what is called zuhud. Zuhud is abstinence, control, taking from the dunya what we need, not trying to get all of it. But this is what has happened to Muslims. And so Muslims will suffer in different parts of the world, whether it's in Chechnya, or it's in Bosnia, or it's in Burma, or in Kashmir, or Somalia, or whatever. Wherever Muslims suffer, we don't find the rest of the Muslim world rising to their aid. Sacrificing, putting aside the dunya and coming to their aid to fight alongside them in defense of Muslim lives and Muslim property. Jihad is lost amongst us. The only jihad we heard was when Saddam, you know, when the Americans were coming for Saddam, and all of a sudden he was talking about jihad. You know. It's a joke. In the Muslim world, jihad is seen as a political statement that leaders will say to promote their cause. It doesn't have the meaning that it had in the times past when Muslims were practicing and the ummah was strong. So we have to look at this fast, you know, and its implications, because when we speak of taqwa, when we speak of generosity, you know, control, moderation, this is not something unique to Ramadan. This is something which should be throughout our lives. This is why I entitled this presentation, Fasting, a Way of Life. And we can see that from Prophet's instructions to us after Ramadan to fast 6 days of Shawwal, that it has the reward along with Ramadan as fasting the whole year. He used to fast Mondays and Thursdays, 3 days of the lunar month, 13, 14, 15, certain days in the year, Arafah, Ashura, etc. Throughout the year, there are different days he fasted also. So that encouragement is fasting continues throughout the year. Reminding us that fasting, as I said, is a way of life. And it should be helping us to grow. But there's an aspect of the fast that we should also reflect on. And that is the inner aspect with regards to how we communicate, how we interact with other people. Because we live in societies, and as such, what you find is that it's the norm that people discuss other people, their business, and I mean, we sit down with conversations. Much of our conversation is involved in talking about other people. Did you hear what so-and-so did? Did you see what so-and-so was doing? So a lot of talking about people. And we find from the Prophet's statements with regards to fasting that he said, a person who doesn't abandon lies and acting on them during Ramadan, Allah will not reward his leaving food and drink. Allah has no need for this. There is no reward for it. مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلْ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَدَعْ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. This is narrated by Imam Bukhari. That in Ramadan we are not supposed to be talking about people, spreading rumors about people, gossiping, backbiting, all of these kind of things. It destroys the value of the fast. So we end up, as the Prophet ﷺ, you know, had said, رُبَّ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعِ وَرُبَّ قَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ قِيَامِهِ إِلَّا السَّهَرِ. Perhaps a fasting person will gain nothing from his fast or her fast but hunger. And perhaps the one who stands up at night for prayer will get nothing but tiredness. That without this control, this psychological aspects of the fasting, where we gain control over what is coming out of our mouths. Because we think the fast is what is going in. You prevent things from coming in your mouth. But actually, fasting involves preventing things from coming out of our mouths also. Very, very important part of fasting. But this control, if it is not there, it destroys the fast. It destroys the fast, destroys the value and the reward from fasting. And this is something which we need throughout the year. We need it throughout the year. As the Prophet ﷺ told us, whoever fears Allah on the last day, فَلْيَقُنِ الْخَيْرَ وَلْيَصْمُتْ, should either speak good or be silent. Beware of what we say. Because, as he said also, perhaps a person may say something which they think is very small, it's nothing. But to Allah it is something great. And Allah lights it against this individual and he goes to hell because of it. And when we consider, to some degree, there are elements amongst us who have not restrained their tongues from speaking about others to the point where they have even spoken against the scholars, etc., scholars of Islam. We can see that the essence of the fast is missing. The spirituality which should be gained from the fast is missing. So they become shells. Externally they appear to be practicing Islam, they're fasting and so on, but internally there's a vacuum there. So they don't feel any kind of ill or any kind of reservation to want to stop themselves from speaking about others. Rumors, spreading gossip. Considering that the Prophet ﷺ had said, لا يدخل الجنة نمام, that the gossiper, the one who's constantly spreading gossip, would not enter paradise. So severe, so critical. But we find Muslims very keen, very anxious to talk about the honor of their fellow Muslim. He's a this, he's a that, he does this, he does that, she does this, she does that. By the fast being destroyed, our whole lives are being destroyed. Taqwa is missing. We're not gaining it. And the fast going from Ramadan to Ramadan is not giving us any of the blessings which the Prophet ﷺ spoke about. When he said that from one fast to the next, from one Ramadan to the next, erases sins in between. The kind of fast that we're doing erases no sin. The Prophet ﷺ said when Ramadan comes, the doors of paradise are open. That meaning a chance to do good deeds which will take us to paradise is there. Allah has given us this chance. But we pass Ramadan through, we have not taken anything from it. We don't take that opportunity. So much so that we have amongst us today the phenomena of what they call the Ramadan Muslim. 11 months of the year, in practice, he's a kafir. He's not praying, he's not praying. But Ramadan comes, you see him in the masjid. You only see him in the masjid in Ramadan. Praying, fasting, everything. The Ramadan Muslim. And I remember being introduced to another concept, which was called Jumu'at al-Wida. Jumu'at al-Wida. What is Jumu'at al-Wida? I'd never heard about it before. This sister from Pakistan told me about it. She said, Jumu'at al-Wida, you know, because I said I knew of Hajj, you know, Hijjat al-Wida, the farewell pilgrimage of the Prophet ﷺ. We have Tawaf al-Wida, you know, the farewell Tawaf when you were making Hajj or Umrah before you leave Mecca. But Jumu'at al-Wida, she said, well, this Jumu'at al-Wida, as she had been told, was the last Jumu'ah in Ramadan. That if you catch that last Jumu'ah in Ramadan, it makes up for the whole year of prayers. This is another one. Of course, I have to tell her, of course, there's no such thing. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never spoke of such a thing. No Jumu'at al-Wida. The last Friday of Jumu'ah is like any Friday in Jumu'ah. Last Friday of Ramadan is like any Friday. It has no special blessings in that sense. And of course, you know, for those who aren't caught up in Jumu'at al-Wida, for them, there is Laylatul Qadr. Okay, we have Laylatul Qadr. Right? It's worth 1,000 months of worship. But this is true. This is true. This is fact. This is in the Quran. Laylatul Qadri khayrun min alf shahr. And they took out their calculators, you know, hit the calculators. 83.3 years of worship. If you catch Laylatul Qadr. So maybe they don't pray through Ramadan, they just wait for the 27th. They say, this is the night. I will stay up all night in prayer to catch this Laylatul Qadr here. For the life. But of course, we don't know what night Laylatul Qadr is. Prophet ﷺ informed us, you know, you can seek it in the last 10. It's not precise. We don't know. It varies from year to year, can vary from year to year. And even you think you are on that night, the 27th, but maybe you started your fast a day early or a day late, and it's not the night you thought. So it's not precise that one night you can catch it. And in any case, if we've not been praying all year long, what kind of prayer are we going to make that night? What kind of prayer can we make that night? You know, this is the mistaken cultural understanding now of Ramadan for us. And so we go from Ramadan to Ramadan, no difference. It hasn't purified us. It hasn't removed any sins. It hasn't increased our faith. We just gained weight. That's all. From one Ramadan to the next, we gain weight. So, I think we need to stop for a minute. We're still in the beginnings of Ramadan. We need to stop for a minute and question ourselves. If this is the fact, if what I've been saying is the reality, we are all living it, then we need to stop here and say, hey, let me not make the rest of Ramadan the way it's been. Let me change it. Because we can change. We're not locked as robots into a particular program where we can't change. We cannot, you know, do it in another way. Alhamdulillah, we have free will. We know what is right. We've been reminded of what is right. Then we can do it. So I would hope, inshallah, that all of you and myself would make a new step. Starting tomorrow for the rest of this month, month of fasting, that we would try to change and go back to the sunnah, to do it in the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this month, because when we look at why it is that Allah chose this month for fasting, we find Allah tells us in the Quran, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن وذن للناس وبينات من هدى, that this is the month in which the Quran was revealed. Clear guidance for people. This is the blessed month, not the holy month. Please, people call this the holy month of Ramadan, like the holy prophet and the holy Quran. Please, this terminology is Christian terminology. They have the holy Bible, that's their thing. We don't have any holy Quran. We have the Quran al-Kareem, the noble Quran, al-Quran al-Azim, the magnificent Quran. We have these terms. This is what Allah, we never have, hear the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or we hear Allah saying, al-Quran al-Muqaddas. Oh. Al-Ard al-Muqaddasa, talking about, you know, Palestine, Jerusalem. But no, Quran, no. No holy Quran, no holy Prophet, no holy Ramadan. Please, let us stop this. It's something we have picked up from colonial times, when we were ruled by our colonial masters and they were talking about their holy Bible. We wanted to have something holy also, so we made a holy Quran and a holy Ramadan. But the point is that this month of fasting, chosen by Allah in honor of the revelation of the Quran. And this is a reminder for us that the Quran should be the foundation of our lives. Not the book that we keep on the highest shelf, that we take down during Ramadan, we blow off the dust, and we sit and read it during Ramadan, and we put it back on the shelf for the rest of the year. No. This book is the book of guidance for us, that we should be reading on a regular basis. We should be memorizing from the Quran. We should be learning tajweed to recite it correctly. We should be learning the meanings, reflecting on the meanings. When we read the Quran, it should not be just ritualistically, you know, as it has become amongst us. If we were taught to read the Quran, Khatm al-Quran or whatever as children, so now we read the Quran, we just, you know, our minds can be elsewhere doing all kinds of other things and, you know, planning for breaking the fast and the foods and all the things, and lots of lips are going through the motions of reading the Quran. This is not the reading of Quran. Allah asks us, don't we reflect? أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, you know, or are our hearts sealed up? Quran is recited to them when they tuliyat alayhim al-Quran, that their hearts become softened. Many of us, we have lost this. There is no softness to our hearts. The Quran is not touching us. It is not moving us. It's not moving us to tears. The only time we cry, you know, is when our team loses, you know, in a cricket game or soccer or something. This is when tears come down our eyes. You know, how could the team lose? But for the sake of Allah, how many of us experience that in our lives? Tears coming to our eyes when we reflect on the Quran, when we reflect on Allah, when we reflect on our sins and our position now. Where is our humility before Allah?
The reading of the Quran in this month is supposed to help us to develop this. Quran should be the foundation. Without that, then the hearts really, our hearts become hardened. This is why we don't have any difficulty in speaking about other people. You know? Defaming people, dishonoring people. We don't have a problem with it because our hearts have become hardened. No longer plays a major role in our lives. So what happens, unfortunately, you will find people will come into Islam newly, and instead of people sitting them down, teaching them the Quran, memorize the Quran so you can use it in your prayers and learn tajweed, read the Quran regularly, so on, person comes into Islam and you find people will be drawing them aside and telling them things. You know, either watch out for so and so. You know, he's no good. You know, don't listen to his khutbas, don't read his books, don't listen to his tapes. You know, so the person from, he's just coming to Islam and now he's, you know, he's knowing, hey, this sheikh is no good, that sheikh is no good, this one is no, he becomes an expert on defining who is good and who is not the sheikhs and who has knowledge, who has, but you ask him, brother, you learned how to read Quran yet? Oh, no, inshallah. He's become an expert, you know, what they call a jarah wa ta'adil, you know, he knows now, he's a specialist in identifying the good, the specialist, and foundation is completely missing. But there he is talking about people. And he will speak about, you know, people who may be among the awliya of Allah. He will say statements and he will point fingers at people. When you go and see these people and see them in their own practice of the deen, etc., etc., you know, these people may very well be among the awliya of Allah. Those close friends of Allah, that Allah calls his awliya, about whom he said that if someone harms one of my awliya, I declare war against him or her. That they're bringing upon themselves the war unleashed by Allah on them. Instead of focusing on the foundation of the deen, building that foundation, learning, establishing that connection with the Quran, which is guidance, which has in it, as Allah says, a shifa lima fi sudur, a cure for what is in the hearts, what is in the chest, the feelings, the illnesses, our psychological, our spiritual illnesses, the cure is there in the Quran. But we are not taking it. Ramadan goes and the Quran goes. We need to get back in touch with our Ramadan. We need to save Ramadan for ourselves, for our own sake, because Allah has no need for our fasts. Ramadan does not benefit Allah in any way. Ramadan was prescribed for our benefit. If we want it, if we want to grow, if we want Islam to have meaning in our lives, then we must establish it in Ramadan. Because Ramadan is the mini, condensed element of Islam. It's been condensed down into Ramadan, packaged in a very tight package, where we have a requirement, all the various things that we have to do throughout the year, it's focused here in Ramadan. If we can't make it in Ramadan, then we're not making it any other time. So we need to reestablish our connection with Ramadan, and in that way, fasting becomes for us a way of life, a way of living. It will affect all of our actions. We will grow spiritually. We will feel something. We'll come out of Ramadan feeling refreshed. We will long for the next Ramadan, as
The Sahaba were described. They used to long for Ramadan. But we don't have that longing. If we do, it's just the longing for the sweets and whatever, you know. But longing for Ramadan as Ramadan, we've lost it. So I pray that Allah would put in our hearts a desire to make Ramadan real in our lives. That we would spend some time in the morning, in the evening, in the time when we're breaking our fast. The Prophet ﷺ said that the dua which is made at the time of the breaking of the fast is a dua which is guaranteed an answer. Most of us, we don't break the fast again. Let's just eat. We've lost no dua, nothing. And if we manage to get out, you know, Allahumma laka sumtu, or the more accurate one, you know, ذهب الظما وابتلت الأروق. We managed to get this dua out. That's it. We're eating. The dua. Ask Allah. I hope and I pray that Allah would give us the tawfiq to ask. Use these opportunities for special blessings from Allah in Ramadan to transform our Ramadan into a religious duty with consequence in our lives, which would make us better human beings, better Muslims, and deserving of Allah's mercy and deserving ultimately of paradise. In the case of those people who don't know Arabic, that when they're reading the Quran, they may have a mushaf with them, and they read from the Arabic and they read from the translation, whether it's in Urdu or English or whatever. Is this permissible? No, it's not permissible. In our salah, you know, nothing from, as Prophet ﷺ said, nothing from people's speech is appropriate in there. The translation is no longer the word of Allah, you know. So we're using people's speech in, though it is a translation of the meaning, it is a person's writing of that meaning, his understanding. So we're reading the speech of people in our prayer, so it's not appropriate. Because the idea of trying to finish the Quran, you know, during Ramadan, which has led people to want to do this, where it's really what they're doing is getting back into the ritual of finishing the Quran in Ramadan, as opposed to reflecting, reciting and reflecting on the meanings of the Quran. I think, you know, it would be better to recite what we know, reflecting on those meanings, learning the meanings of it and recite what we know, and try during Ramadan to learn more of the Quran, you know, and of course outside of Ramadan, you know. I don't think it's a preferable practice, and especially, you know, if you will find in some masjid, some places, the imam may take a mushaf, he's reading it during Ramadan, Taraweeh, this, and then other people will stand behind him with mushafs also, in their prayer. But this is definitely for the others is not acceptable. For the imam, one leading as an individual, who is reciting, there are some narrations which permit it, but it is not a preferable practice, you know. The rak'ah, or the units of prayers of Taraweeh, well, the basic we know is there in Sahih Bukhari, where Aisha radiallahu anha, you know, had said that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray 11 rak'at, 4, 4 and 3, during Ramadan and outside of Ramadan, you know, he didn't do more than that. This was the general practice of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so we would say that for Taraweeh, this is the preferable number. But if a person, because this is Sunnah, it is voluntary prayer, if a person wants to pray more rak'at, you know, as in tahajjud, praying, because really Taraweeh is just tahajjud in Ramadan, we're just doing it together, but it's really tahajjud. If a person wants to do more, they can. But if a person now says 20, and they've got this number 20, and this is what everybody should do, then this now becomes a form of innovation, you know, where it is being prescribed for everybody to do this number, and this number is not authentically attributed to Omar radiallahu anhu. Though people say Omar is the one who started it, there are no authentic narrations to confirm that. If you want to do 20, no problem,
But now to insist on it for others, this now becomes a problem, because you're then making something a requirement in the deen which the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ didn't do. And the religion was complete with him. A brother's question, a person traveling from Canada to Saudi Arabia or Saudi Arabia to Canada, in terms of their fasting, is it allowed for them to break the fast? Of course. The traveler is allowed to break the fast. The companions, some of them fasted, some of them didn't fast, you know, in their own practice. And the Prophet ﷺ had said that it is not from piety to fast while traveling.
Even from Ottawa to Toronto?
From Ottawa to Toronto.
Driving.
Well, the point is that if the journey is, you know, a true journey, you know, not just a visit and popping back, but you're making a trip, which would consider to be travel, then you may fast or not. But the point is that when he said it is not from piety to fast, it doesn't mean that it is impious for you to fast. No. It's just meaning that don't think that by fasting it is more pious than not fasting. That is the point. It is no more pious to fast while traveling than not fast. So if you wish to fast so that you don't have to make up the fast afterwards, you may do that. But if you choose to take this concession which Allah has given, then the rukhsa, then you know it is perfectly acceptable and you make up your fast afterwards.
And you're fasting.
Okay, a little brother's question, is it permissible to put lip gloss on your lips whilst fasting and to brush your teeth while fasting? Well, lip gloss, I mean, some of them have taste to them, right? You know, they've got strawberry versions and other versions, right? You know, where, you know, the temptation is there, and it's not just on your lip, you're tasting them, you know. And then you're licking your lips, and you know, next thing you know, really, you're putting on more, and you're licking and putting on more. And you started, you know, eating some strawberry lip gloss, and Ramadan. So there, it's not acceptable. If it's just on your lip and you're not doing that, because it's preventing it from cracking because of the weather or whatever, and it's better to get the one without the taste, you know, which you're not likely to be licking, then it's permissible. And also to brush your teeth, though it is true, Prophet ﷺ had said, you know, quoting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the breath, the bad smelling breath of the one who is fasting is sweeter to Allah than musk. Right? The beautiful scent of musk. It is sweeter to Allah than musk. Some people have mistakenly understood from this that we should cultivate this. Right? In Ramadan, don't brush your teeth because Allah loves the smell. You know? But no. No, we have to put this within the context of the deen as a whole. Prophet Muhammad, though he said that, he used to use miswak in Ramadan. And he said, were it not for the difficulty it would have placed on my ummah, I would have made it compulsory to use the miswak before every prayer. Why? Because it freshens the breath. We're praying, turning to each other and salam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. You know, this is the point. You know, freshen the breath so that, you know, we're not harming our brothers and sisters that we're praying besides. So it is perfectly legitimate. It is from the sunnah to use miswak or whatever functions as miswak. Somebody said, well, toothpaste has a taste. Miswak has a taste. I mean, of course, the miswaks that we might be getting from here, you know, which are old and dried out and these kind of things, you know, so when you use it, it's just like, you know, some piece of wood rubbing on your teeth. This is not the real miswak, right? The miswak, which is from, you know, Arabia, India, wherever it's growing, you know, there it's a root, and that root is filled with sap. It is moist, and it has a taste, and it does clean, it will have a taste. Of course, you don't swallow it, you spit it out. But it will freshen the breath. So toothpaste functions in a similar way. It is permissible to use toothpaste also.
What about don't?
Oh, a brother is asking about people who are inside the masjid using the miswak, you know, and the taste that is collecting there with the saliva, where is this going? Well, maybe if you look under the rugs, you might find it. Sure. I mean, we should be careful that using it, you should spit it out. You don't swallow it now. You know, if you're using this, your mouth like this,
Outside of Ramadan, okay, fine, no problem, swallow it, okay. But in Ramadan, fasting, then, and we've built up something there from using miswak, we should spit it out. Because otherwise, then we are involved in a process of what could be considered breaking the fast, inadvertently.
Is it considered as a sunnah to do miswak either in a mosque and continue it? I don't know where to...
There is asking, is it from the sunnah to use the miswak in the masjid? Yes, it is. It is. We did.
Then where this material goes?
Well, remember the mosque in the time of the Prophet Muhammad, you know, was just gravel, open air, sunshine, rain would come, you know. So, if you had to spit, you could spit in the masjid. Right? But now things have changed. Okay, we have to take this into account. Because of course, it's now spitting in the masjid is a problem. So, you know, I mean, this is where we have to, I mean, yes, it's from the sunnah, you know, just as it was from the sunnah to pray in shoes, wearing shoes, also in the masjid. But again, today you come, you know, during the winter with the snow and the stuff on your boots, come marching into the masjid to pray, you're going to be hurting other people.
Some people, they do practice.
Yeah, this is where, again, you know, there has to be what they call fiqh, understanding, you know. It's not just you take hadith, Prophet ﷺ did this, so I'm just going to do it, no matter what, you know. There's a misunderstanding, you know, because it's, you know, the point is that the sunnah is applied with understanding. There's certain aspects of the sunnah, okay, there's no understanding, Prophet ﷺ said, we didn't know, don't sleep on your stomach. Okay, in the times of the past, we didn't know. Now we found out recently that sleeping on your stomach does cause problems, back problems, etc., etc. It also... They found that is one of the biggest factors in cot death for children who die in the ages of 1, 2, so on and so. The doctors have warned, don't put your children to sleep in the stomachs, on the stomachs. So something like that, where the Prophet tells us, don't do this or do this or so and so, where we're not able to figure out necessarily why or not, we go ahead and we do these things. But where there are things where the consequence of it is, can obviously become harmful in our times, and we look back in the time of Prophet Muhammad and we see when it was done, it wasn't harmful, then we have to apply it similarly, meaning that if we're traveling on the road, time for salah comes, we can get out of the car, stop on the side, and we pray with our shoes on, no problem. But if we have a masjid now where we have rugs and all these other kind of things, then we have to, because it's also sunnah to pray with your shoes off. So we have to apply that sunnah. It's more appropriate. The question, those who don't fast and pray, should they celebrate Eid? What? I can't say they shouldn't celebrate Eid. What they're celebrating, I don't know. Right? Because they're not celebrating the breaking of the fast because they didn't fast. You know, it's obviously, it's just a cultural thing, you know. I would not say, don't come to our place of the prayer. So, better they come, maybe hear something from the Imam that maybe might touch their heart and, you know, cause them to do this. But of course, unless there is a desire inside themselves at some point, somewhere, you know, for good, then it's obviously a meaningless practice, just purely cultural. Mm-hmm. Oh, you asked a question before, okay. Brother had his hand up before. Okay, go ahead.
What you can do?
Okay, a brother's suggestion, question, concerning many of the adults who have come as immigrants here, who don't have access to the Quran. What can we do? Because back home in our countries, maybe there were sheikhs in the masjids teaching, so a person could go and get this kind of learning. Of course, what we're saying here is that there does need to be programs in the masjids, in the centers, for adults. I mean, we shouldn't just focus on the children and forget the adults, because we all need to be close to the Quran. In a way, the parents are themselves close to the Quran, this will help that generation coming up being close to the Quran. Because it's difficult to teach the child Quran, stress on it, and his parents don't read Quran. Or her parents don't read Quran. You know? But we should have programs for teaching Quran for adults.
About this teaching?
Well, alhamdulillah, and our brothers was mentioning, just for sisters who might not have heard it, is that there was a program set up in Dar Sunnah, and for adults, But unfortunately, very few people attended, and they entered it for a little while, and they dropped out. You know, this is unfortunate. We have to keep trying, though. I think, you know, even so, this happens, and this is how it is. I know myself when I first came into Islam. You know, we used to have Arabic in the masjid in Toronto. We used to go to Balstead Avenue, different places, to try to learn Arabic. Yeah. And the classes will always start out, you know, big at the beginning. You know, after a couple of months, it drops. There's only a few people to find it. The teacher says, okay, you know, what's the point? It's just you and the teacher left, you know. So it would stop and it would start again, back to Alif Bata, you know. In the case of those people who don't know Arabic, that when they're reading the Quran, they may have a mushaf with them. They read from the Arabic and they read from the translation, whether it's in Urdu or English or whatever. Is this permissible? No, it's not permissible. In our salah, you know, nothing from, as Prophet ﷺ said, nothing from people's speech is appropriate in there. The translation is no longer the word of Allah, you know. So we're using people's speech in, though it is a translation of the meaning, it is a person's writing of that meaning, his understanding. So we're reading the speech of people in our prayer, so it's not appropriate. Because the idea of trying to finish the Quran, you know, during Ramadan, which has led people to want to do this, where it's really what they're doing is getting back into the ritual of finishing the Quran in Ramadan, as opposed to reflecting, reciting and reflecting on the meanings of the Quran. I think, you know, it would be better to recite what we know, reflecting on those meanings, learning the meanings of it and recite what we know, and try during Ramadan to learn more of the Quran. You know, and of course outside of Ramadan, you know. I don't think it's a preferable practice. And especially, you know, if you find in some masjid, some places, the imam may take a mushaf, he's reading it during Ramadan, Taraweeh. And then other people would stand behind him with mushafs also, in their prayer. And this is definitely for the others is not acceptable. For the imam, one leading as an individual, who is reciting, there are some narrations which permit it, but it is not a preferable practice, you know. The rak'ah, or the units of prayers of Taraweeh, well, the basic, we know, is there in Sahih Bukhari, where Aisha radhiallahu anha, you know, had said that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray 11 rak'at, 4, 4 and 3, during Ramadan and outside of Ramadan, you know, he didn't do more than that. This was the general practice of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so he would say that for Taraweeh, this is the preferable number. But if a person, because this is sunnah, it is voluntary prayer, if a person wants to pray more rak'at, you know, as in tahajjud, praying, because really Taraweeh is just tahajjud in Ramadan. We're just doing it together, but it's really tahajjud. If a person wants to do more, they can. But if a person now says 20, and they've got this number 20, and this is what everybody should do, then this now becomes a form of innovation, you know, where it is being prescribed for everybody to do this number, and this number is not authentically attributed to Omar radiallahu anhu. Though people say Omar is the one who started it, there are no authentic narrations to confirm that. If you want to do 20, no problem. But now to insist on it for others, this now becomes a problem, because you're then making something a requirement in the deen, which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't do. And the religion was complete with him. About this question, a person traveling from Canada to Saudi Arabia or Saudi Arabia to Canada, and in terms of their fasting, is it allowed for them to break the fast? Of course. The traveler is allowed to break the fast. The companions, some of them fasted, some of them didn't fast, you know, in their own practice. And the Prophet ﷺ had said that it is not from piety to fast while traveling.
Even from Ottawa to Toronto?
From Ottawa to Toronto.
Driving.
Well, the point is that if the journey is, you know, a true journey, you know, not just a visit and popping back, but you're making a trip, which you would consider to be travel, then you may fast or not. But the point is that when he said it is not from piety to fast, it doesn't mean that it is impious for you to fast. No. It's just meaning that don't think that By fasting, it is more pious than not fasting. That is the point. It is more pious to fast while traveling than not fast. So, if you wish to fast so that you don't have to make up the fast afterwards, you may do that. But if you choose to take this concession which Allah has given, then you ruhsah, then you know it is perfectly acceptable and you make up your fast afterwards.
When you're fasting.
Okay, a little brother's question, is it permissible to put lip gloss on your lips whilst fasting and to brush your teeth while fasting? Well, lip gloss, I mean, some of them have taste to them, right? You know, they've got strawberry versions and other versions, right? You know, where, you know, the temptation is there, and it's not just on your lip, you're tasting it, you know. And then you're licking your lips, and you know, next thing you know, really, you're putting on more, and you're licking and putting on more. And you started, you know, eating some strawberry lip gloss and Ramadan. So there, it's not acceptable. If it's just on your lip and you're not doing that, because it's preventing it from cracking because of the weather or whatever, and it's better to get the one without the taste, you know, which you're not likely to be licking, then it's permissible. And also to brush your teeth, though it is true, Prophet ﷺ had said, you know, quoting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the breath, the bad smelling breath of the one who is fasting is sweeter to Allah than musk. Right? The beautiful scent of musk. It is sweeter to Allah than musk. Some people have mistakenly understood from this that we should cultivate this. Right? In Ramadan, don't brush your teeth because Allah loves the smell. You know? But no. You know, we have to put this within the context of the deen as a whole. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, though he said that, he used to use miswak in Ramadan. And he said, were it not for the difficulty it would have placed on my ummah, I would have made it compulsory to use the miswak before every prayer. Why? Because it freshens the breath. We're praying, turning to each other and salah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. You know, this is the point. You know, freshen the breath so that, you know, we're not harming our brothers and sisters that we're praying besides. So it is perfectly legitimate. It is from the sunnah to use miswak or whatever functions as miswak. Somebody says, well, toothpaste has a taste. Miswak has a taste. I mean, of course, the miswaks that we might be getting from here, you know, which are old and dried out and these kind of things, you know, so when you use it, it's just like, you know, some piece of wood rubbing on your teeth. This is not the real miswak, right? The miswak, which is from, you know, Arabia, India, wherever it's growing, you know, there it's a root, and that root is filled with sap. It is moist, and it has a taste, and it does clean, it will have a taste. Of course, you don't swallow it, you spit it out, but it will freshen the breath. So toothpaste functions in a similar way. It is permissible to use toothpaste also.
What about don't?
Oh, if brother is asking about people who are inside the masjid using the miswak, you know, and the taste that is collecting there with the saliva, where is this going? Well, maybe if you look under the rugs, you might find something. Sure. I mean, we should be careful that using it, you should spit it out. You don't swallow it now. You know, if you're using this, your mouth like this, outside of Ramadan, okay, fine, no problem, swallow it. Okay. But in Ramadan, fasting, then, and we've built up something there from using miswak, we should spit it out. Because otherwise, then we are involved in a process of what could be considered breaking the fast, inadvertently.
Is it considered as a sunnah that do miswak either in a mosque and continue it? I don't know where
the brother is asking, is it from the sunnah to use the miswak in the masjid? Yes, it is. It is. We did.
Then where this material goes?
Well, remember the mosque in the time of the Prophet Muhammad, you know, was just gravel, open air, sunshine, rain would come, you know. So if you had to spit, you could spit in the masjid, right? But now things have changed. Okay, we have to take this into account, because of course it's now spitting in the masjid is a problem. So, you know, I mean, this is where we have to, I mean, yes, it's from the sunnah, you know, just as it was from the sunnah to pray in shoes, wearing shoes, also in the masjid. But again, today you come, you know, during the winter with the snow and the stuff on your boots, come marching into the masjid to pray, you're going to be hurting other people.
Some people, they do practice.
Yeah, this is where, again, you know, there has to be what they call fiqh, understanding, you know. It's not just you take hadith, Prophet did this, so I'm just going to do it, no matter what, you know. There's a misunderstanding. You know, because it's, you know, the point is that the sunnah is applied with understanding. There's certain aspects of the sunnah, okay, there's no understanding. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, we didn't know, don't sleep on your stomach. Okay, in the times of the past, we didn't know. Now we found out recently that sleeping on your stomach does cause problems, back problems, etc., etc. It also, they found that is one of the biggest factors in cot death for children who die in the ages of 1, 2, so on and so. The doctors have warned, don't put your children to sleep in the stomachs, on the stomachs. So something like that, where the Prophet ﷺ tells us, don't do this or do this or so and so, where we're not able to figure out necessarily why or not, we go ahead and we do these things. But where there are things where the consequence of it is can obviously become harmful in our times, and we look back in the time of Prophet ﷺ and we see when it was done, it wasn't harmful, then we have to apply it similarly, meaning that if we're traveling on the road, time for salah comes, we can get out of the car, stop on the side, and we pray with our shoes on, no problem. But if we have a masjid now where we have rugs and all these other kind of things, then we have to, because it's also sunnah to pray with your shoes off. So we have to apply that sunnah. It's more appropriate. The question, those who don't fast and pray, should they celebrate Eid? What? I can't say they shouldn't celebrate Eid. What they're celebrating, I don't know. Right? Because they're not celebrating the breaking of the fast because they didn't fast. You know, it's obviously, it's just a cultural thing, you know. I would not say, don't come to our place of the prayer. And the better they come, maybe hear something from the imam that maybe might touch their heart and, you know, cause them to do this. But of course, unless there is a desire inside themselves at some point, somewhere, you know, for good, then it's obviously a meaningless practice, just purely cultural. Oh, you asked a question before, okay. Brother had his hand up before, okay, go ahead.
What we can do in this area?
Okay, a brother's suggestion, question, concerning many of the adults who have come as immigrants here, who don't have access to the Quran. What can we do? Because back home in our countries, maybe there were sheikhs in the masjids teaching, so a person could go and get this kind of learning. Of course, what we're saying here is that there does need to be programs in the masjids, in the centers, for adults. I mean, we shouldn't just focus on the children and forget the adults, because we all need to be close to the Quran. In a way, the parents are themselves close to the Quran, this will help that generation coming up being close to the Quran. Because it's difficult to teach the child Quran, stress on it, and his parents don't read Quran. Or her parents don't read Quran. You know? But we should have programs for teaching Quran for adults. Well, alhamdulillah, and our brothers was mentioning, just for the sisters who might not have heard it, is that there was a program set up in Dar Sunnah, and for adults, but unfortunately very few people attended, and they entered it for a little while and they dropped out, you know. This is unfortunate. We have to keep trying though. I think, you know, even so this happens, and this is how it is. I know myself, when I first came into Islam, you know, we used to have Arabic in the masjid in Toronto. We used to go to Balsed Avenue, different places, to try to learn Arabic. And the classes would always start out, you know, big at the beginning. You know, after a couple of months, it drops. There's only a few people, till finally the teacher says, okay, you know, what's the point? It's just you and the teacher left, you know. So it would stop and it would start again, back to Alif Bata, you know.